You know, folks, there's only one thing that Mark and I like almost as much as drumming, and that is good coffee. And so here at Rock My Bean, we have put together five of our favorite coffees from around the world that are roasted fresh on order and mailed to you right away. If you're interested in helping autism awareness, every purchase of this coffee, a percentage goes to the National Autistic Association to help autistic parents, help young people, help autistic adults. And we take this very seriously. Now, we have put together these five flavors. Each one is named after a specific drum from a specific part of the world. And we'll be expanding this this line of coffees as we go. But these five are our favorites, and we want to share them with you. So if you're interested in drumming and coffee and helping with autistic awareness, please visit us at brainygourmet.com. Click on the Rock My Bean link, and happy coffee drinking. Hi, everybody. It's John from Rock My Bean. This is The Record Shelf. We are finally at the end of the Who's Next album from 1971. And this album has some tremendous music on it. Tremendous. A lot of these songs were written by Pete Townsend, for the Lifehouse Project, which was going to be like Tommy and Quadrophenia. It was going to be a musical, maybe a movie. But it was shelved. It never was made. And a lot of these songs from that he wrote for that got on this album, Who's Next, which is part of the reason why it's such a great album. So the next two songs, and the last two songs we're going to do here, is Behind Blue Eyes and We Won't Get Fooled Again. Two tremendously great songs, and both these songs made it to radio and were hits on the radio. Now, Behind Blue Eyes is written from the perspective of a guy who's hated, and he's shunned. And he's asking for empathy, but he's not really getting it. Also, Townsend wrote this song about a character in this Lifehouse project, which was going to be, like I said, similar to the Who's, to Tommy and Quadrophenia. But basically, the lyrics are based on the Who guitarist Townsend, whose own feeling of his own angst, and no one knows what it's like to be him, with high expectations and pressure to be someone that he isn't. And you know, a lot of famous musicians feel this. They feel like they've got to stay on top. They got to be on top all the time. And there's a lot of pressure, and a lot of pressure to be friendly with people that you don't even know. In fact, Neil Peart, the drummer from Rush, wrote a song called Tom Sawyer, which was an incredible hit, that was about this alienation you feel with your fans who think that they're your friends just because they like your music or they know your name. There was an incident, apparently, not sure if it's been confirmed or not. There was an incident with Townsend, a run-in with a groupie when he was in Denver, touring in Denver. And he came so close to being tempted by this groupie, but he rejected it. And he wrote this song basically like a prayer. I'm not going to be tempted by what they're throwing at me. I'm married. I don't want to ruin my relationship. I don't want to be tempted by this momentary lapse. I want to be strong, and it's so hard to do. And I imagine it is hard to do. I've never been tempted by groupies. Well, maybe a tiny bit, very tiny bit when I was a musician back in the day, very small. But the temptation must be enormous for famous musicians, and Townsend wrote about that. So Behind Blue Eyes is a song about angst and the stress of being at the top all the time, even when you don't feel like it. So let's start out with Behind Blue Eyes, and let's listen to it right now.
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man behind blue eyes. No one knows what it's like to be hated, to be faded, to telling only lies. But my dreams, they aren't as empty as my conscience seems to be. it's never free. No one knows what it's like to feel these feelings like I do, and I blame you. No one bites back as hard on their anger. None of my pain and woe can show through. That's never free. When my fist clenches, crack it open.
Nice. Behind Blue Eyes. Well, there you go, folks. Excellent song. Once again, Keith Moon's drumming is just awesome. I can't get enough of this guy. Whenever he plays, I'm focused on the drummer. I try to listen to the guitar player and the bass player and the singer, too. And don't forget, Roger Daltrey's singing is tremendous here. But I just love Keith Moon's drumming. And I'm a drummer. I can't get away from it. He's just... I can't imagine the Who playing this without Keith behind the drums. I can't even imagine it. To me, it's not the same. It's completely not the same. His drumming just takes it to a level so much higher than it already is. So there you go, folks. Behind Blue Eyes, some great harmonization, great singing, great emotional investment by Roger Daltrey in this. And of course, you know, Pete Townsend's great tooling on the guitar. Really good stuff. And of course, we can't forget John Entwistle's bass playing here. It couldn't have been easy to play bass guitar with Keith Moon. It had to have been a challenge. But apparently, John Entwistle was up to that challenge because he did a fantastic job. All right, so the next song on the album is We Won't Get Fooled Again. And this one is one of my favorites. It's a political song. It's a song about political revolution. And in the first verse, you hear that there's an uprising happening. And the synthesizer represents the revolution starting. And it builds at the beginning when the uprising is starting. And then it comes back at the end when a new revolution is starting. And in the middle of the song, they overthrow those in power. But in the end, the new regime becomes as corrupt as the old one. And we start over again. So it's explaining the futility of human political institutions. And there are so many people in the world, and I've been around for the Cold War, I was around for all the political revolutions and, you know, anti-colonial revolutions that occurred in the 60s, 70s, 80s, that we can see that no matter what happens, no matter who gets in power, we think they're great, we think that they're gonna be different than the last guy, we think that they're gonna be untouched by corruption, that they're the answer to all our problems, and they end up being corrupt and falling into corruption, and it starts all over again. It's the futility of human institutions, this song is really about. And I know it irks those that think that our answers to all our human problems is politics, but this song lays it out and says, no, politics is not a solution. It is never a solution because we are constantly being fooled again. But in this song, he says, no, I'm not going to be fooled again. I'm not going to participate in a stupid revolution. I'm not going to be a part of it because it's going to wind up being as corrupt as the last one. And honestly, Pete Townsend was clearly a student of history because he understood that that's a fact of history. So I'm sure this song, particularly in the early 1970s, late 60s, early 70s, was controversial because, and it's almost like the Beatles revolution song saying, look, I don't want to be a part of your revolution. This is not how we do it. We're not going to be violent. We're not going to kill people. That's not my idea of a revolution. This is going to be a heart revolution. And the Beatles said that in Revolution. Well, in this song, Pete's a little less nice about it and just says, look, I'm not going to be fooled again. We're not, the old boss, his new boss is the same as the old boss, and we're not going to be fooled by this again. So put that all together, and I'm sure these songs kind of rankled those who wanted revolution. Perhaps they wanted a violent revolution. And, you know, this is kind of saying, no, 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 you guys are wrong. You're totally wrong. I don't want to be a part of it. Because you'll wind up just like the guys before you. Well, anyway, that's what this song is about. It's one of my favorite Who songs of all time. And I'm sure you'll agree, if you haven't heard it already, this is a towering work that stands the test of time. And I think even lyrically and historically, this song stands the test of time. So here we go now with We Won't Get Fooled Again. And here we go, right now. There's the keyboard. Revolution's getting started.
In the streets, with our children and I.
Revolution starts over again. This is great. I love this. The drum part comes in, stops, comes in. Good stuff here, folks. Great stuff. Terrific, folks. That's terrific. That is awesome. Love that song. Absolutely love that song. From start to finish, it's just kick butt, man. That is one of the best songs they ever did. And Daltrey's scream there at the end is considered one of the best screams on any rock song. It's a very convincing wail, really convincing scream. I mean, it's so convincing that the rest of the band that was having lunch nearby when they made this thought Daltrey was actually brawling with one of the engineers. That's how real his scream was. It was very convincing. I've had enough. I've had enough of your promises. I've had enough of your revolutions. I've had enough of your lies. This is the best anti-political song ever written. Next time you have an election and you're like, oh my gosh, this guy is the same as this guy, send this song out to everybody and tell them, look, see, this is exactly what the problem is. So, old new boss, same as the old boss. I just love it, love it. Great lyrics, great music, and now I got to talk about Keith Moon's drumming here. It's just amazing. I'm telling you, this guy was so good, and he was all over the map. And I've been a drummer, like I said, I've been a drummer in bands. A lot of bands would not tolerate the busyness of the drumming that Keith Moon did. They just wouldn't do it. They would say, you're getting in the way of the singer. There's just too much going on. You need to back off, carry the rhythm, do your job. You know, I've actually been told that. But Keith Moon, he knew when to back off. There was a time he knew it, and he did it. But a lot of his drumming would never be accepted in a lot of bands, even today, because he was just there. His drumming was in your face, okay? That's how he was. And he was so good at it, so good at it. And I love his style, those triplets, and just amazing drummer. You know, for me, The Who, Keith Moon is at the top of the list. I love Roger Daltrey's singing. It's also great. And, of course, Townsend's guitar and Entwistle's bass. But Keith Moon's drumming makes The Who a special, special band. You just don't find drummers like him anymore, anywhere. I mean, there are great drummers out there, and they're all great at what they do. But Keith Moon was a special, special guy, special drummer. And I'm so grateful that The Who didn't say, come on, Keith, you know, you got to tone it down a bit. You got to back off. You got to lay back a little bit. They didn't tell him to do that. They let him be who he was, and it worked out for their music. It made them a special band. It helped them. It raised the bar for the whole band. And it put The Who in a special place in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It really did help The Who a lot, having a guy like that. And whenever I listen to a Who song, it's Keith that I'm really listening to, because I'm still amazed, even today, with this guy's ability and things he did. Well, that's all we have for this album, folks. We finished Who's Next, 1971. And I hope you've enjoyed this Magic Carpet ride through one of the greatest albums of all time, and especially of the 1970s, The Who, Who's Next. Now, we're probably going to be doing Quadrophenia down the road here, but because we're not done with The Who. They didn't just put out one album and that was it. There's some other great stuff by this band that we're going to do as well. And we've done a lot of other bands too, so please avail yourself to the other videos we've done. Some great albums by great groups of the time, like Rush and Led Zeppelin and Fleetwood Mac and Queen and others. So we've done quite a bit and we're going to keep doing them. Now, we put out a poll every so often for you, the viewer, the participant, to take part in this and tell me what albums you want to hear. Now, the last poll we had, we actually had a tie. We had a tie between, Van Halen 1 and the first Bad Company debut album. So we're doing both those albums. We're going to do those too. But when we're done with those, we're going to do another poll. We're going to start doing the poll before we're done so that you can tell us what we want. We can kind of prepare and get ready for the next album. Now, is there anything that you want to do differently on this show? You think I should do differently? Or you like what we're doing? Please leave a comment behind. And by the way, I want to say this. Forgive me if I get some facts wrong. I try to get my facts right, but sometimes I make a mistake or I get a bad source and I'll say something that it isn't quite true. And it's not because I intentionally did it wrong. It's just sometimes the facts are a little muddy or I didn't get it correct. I apologize for that and I try to correct it as soon as I can. So thank you for anybody out there. If you want to correct something that I've said, a fact about the band or musicians, please feel free. I want the truth to get out about these bands because these are amazing musicians playing amazing music and an amazing time in music history. And we want to give them all the credit they deserve for all the wonderful music that they gave us. When I was young, this music was the soundtrack to my life. And I still listen to it today. There is nothing wrong with this music. In fact, this new generation could benefit from having this music in their life and listening to really great musicians doing what they do best. And you know what? Back then, while there were studios and there were labels and there were all these people out there trying to make money off them, a lot of these bands were given the freedom to be who they were and to do the best they could. And it was between the late 60s and the 1970s was probably the most a creative period of rock music that ever existed. And there was so much freedom given to bands, chances for them to mature and to grow and to improve themselves, that later on, you don't make it on the first album, you don't put a hit song, you're finished. There's no second chance, there's no third chance, there's no fourth chance, you're done. And unfortunately, that stifles the artist who's just learning how to do this. They're just getting together. And as a band, you've got different members who have different ideas and you've got to make them gel. It doesn't always happen on the first shot. Sometimes it does, but usually it doesn't. And so bands were given an opportunity to improve their skills, to improve their songwriting, and to make it come together. A lot of times they failed. They were known as one-hit wonders. But there are others who did, and who did just good enough in the first one. They were given a chance a second time and a third time. And some even started to bomb a second or third time, but the album said, no, well, the label said, we'll give you a chance. We'll give you another chance to come up and see what you can do. And they succeeded. So that's how music was once upon a time. And we are so blessed by that period of music that we are listening to it now, the greatest rock music of all time. And that's The Who, one of the greatest bands of rock history. And I'm just so honored to be able to bring this music to those, to a younger generation, and to those of you my age who grew up with this music. The memories it gives us and how lucky we were to have this as our soundtrack. Oftentimes we don't even realize how lucky we were, but I think we all do now. And so I'm glad that you're joining me on this trip. I hope you'll stay with me, listen to some other reviews we're doing. And as always, thank you for joining me and rock on.